Thank you so much. Thank you. So very happy to be here and excited to be at this event talking about games and gamification. I always like to tell this little story, though. People always want to know, how did you get started studying games, and how did that really happen? Well, it really happened for my two boys. I have one boy named Nick and one boy named Nate, who are much older now than they were a long time ago. One Christmas, we talked about learning technologies, you know, and the Internet of Things. I'm not sure it'll be unintrusive, but certainly we're going to have the Internet of Things. And somebody asked me the other day, what do you think is learning technology? And I was like, what's not learning technology, right? Almost any technology can be used for learning, or we need to learn. So when my younger son was 8 years old, he came up to me and said, Dad, I only want three things this year for Christmas. And I'm thinking, awesome. I'm getting off really easy. So I said, Nick, what would you like? Like an action figure or something? This is like in the 2000s. And he's like, Dad, that's so 1990. I'm like, all right, Nick, well, what do you want for Santa Claus to bring you for Christmas? He says, I want Santa Claus to bring me a big screen TV, a cell phone, and an Xbox. And I'm like, Nick, like, so who are you going to call? Like, you're 8 years old. So I didn't know what to do. So I did what every good father would do. I totally ignored him. And he came up to me again, Dad, I want Santa Claus to bring three things for Christmas. So I thought, maybe he changed his mind. What do you want? You know, the big screen TV, the phone, the Xbox. So now I'm panicked, right? What am I going to do? So I said, the next best thing that dads always do, I said, go talk to your mother. So she was no help. So then he came into me and said, Dad, you know, I want, I'm totally panicked. So I looked at him, I said, Nick, there's no such thing as Santa Claus. So for those of you that don't know, that was a bad thing to say. Nick was really excited at Christmas when Santa Claus brought him the big screen TV, the cell phone, and the Xbox. And 4 months later, my back finally got better from sleeping on the couch. So the whole idea really, though, got me thinking about the use of technology and how much younger kids are. And if you went through that transition, you'll remember the agony, like how old should my child be before I get them a cell phone, right? And is it because I never had one and I'm thinking through? Is it because, so all this technology is really having impact, but to me, their playing of games and their immersion in games really got me thinking, well, why can't we use this for learning? Why do we have to have this separation between games and interaction? And then I played James Bond 007 Nightfire on the PlayStation 2, which is one of the best video games ever created. And one morning at 3 o'clock, when my wife's like, okay, Karl, you know, time to come up to bed now. I'm like, okay, just one more level, and then I'll begin. So I'm like, there's something here that we need to look at. So started studying this thing called gamification. So that's what we're going to look at today. The slides are on my website, so if anybody wants to download the slides, you can download them. If you go to SlideShare, they're there. If you go to the hashtag, DFL Games, search there. I posted that on there today as well, so you can grab that, and I'll post it again later with the same hashtag. So if you like to take notes, take notes. In fact, research shows that actually writing notes down by hand is better than doing it on a computer, but if you know, you're skeptical of research, then you can go ahead and download the slides. So let's go ahead and get started. So the first thing I want you to do is I want you to wear two hats in this presentation. So one is somebody listening to the presentation, hopefully getting some information. But the other one is someone who designs instruction. Everyone in this room has some hand in designing instruction. And I want you to think about, well, what decisions was Karl making when he decided to do this? What decisions were being made? What kind of game elements is he using in this? And just kind of keep a list. And what we're going to do at the end is we're going to play, does anybody in here play Boggle? Yeah, my wife is like really good at Boggle. I'm like really bad at Boggle. But I want you to do it afterwards. You'll turn to your neighbor and you'll, okay, did you get characters? Yeah, I got characters. And you cross them out. So the person that has the most at the end will be the winner. Okay. And it's always better to be a winner than not a winner. Okay, so let's talk about the case of the disengaged learner. It was a Monday morning, a quiet Monday morning, really quiet, almost, you get the point, right? So out of nowhere, she flew into my office like a dean who had a problem that needed to be solved. Hiya, dean. I've got a problem that needs to be solved. We've all been in this situation, right? She wanted to increase engagement and have more interactive learning for her students. We need more engagement. You came to the right person. That's what I do. Yeah, I know. That's why I hired you. Ugh. Now, take this person here and go find out how to make this happen. So this person is you. You're going to help solve the mystery of the disengaged learner. So what we want to do is, for some reason, she didn't seem bothered by the fact that she's breaking the school's no smoking policy. Here's where you come in. You're going to help figure out the clues. So the first thing I want you to do is take out your text machine or your smartphone. Like when I do with this with my students, they already have their phone out. But anyway, go ahead and take your phone out. And then I want you to text my name, Karl Kapp, to 37607. And if you don't have a cell phone, or if you're like over your minutes or your data plan, please don't participate because normal texting fees do apply. So if you don't have an unlimited plan, we don't use a lot of data, but do that. So it should welcome you, Karl Kapp. All lowercase is fine, but it can be capitals as well. No spaces, because if you type Karl space, then it goes to this guy named Karl Marshall somewhere, and he wonders why he gets all these text messages. So go ahead and do that. Yeah, my students would also be done by now, but that's okay. So just take your time and text. Of course, my mother-in-law would be going, text machine, what's that? But my mom, we made a mistake. We showed my mom's 78 years old, and she never wanted to have a smartphone. And then all of a sudden, one day she calls me and says, Karl, I got to get a smartphone. I'm like, Mom, you've held out this long. Like, why now? Does anybody guess why she wanted a smartphone? Grandkids, right. She was at an event where they were showing off grandkids on their phones. And she's like, uh-oh, I got to do that. So now that's what she uses her phone for, pictures. And emojis. She no longer can speak. She just sends emojis. It's the wildest thing I've ever seen. I've never seen anything like it. Yeah, she's really good at it. And my wife's mom, just to, hopefully nobody knows her, but she she doesn't respond to texts. You send her a text and she never responds. She gets it, but she never responds, which drives my wife crazy. Like, did you see the text I sent? Yeah, I saw it. Well, did you answer? Okay, so everybody's got that. All right, so first thing I want you to do is we're going to have to choose our disguise, right? So we're going to have to figure out what disguise we want to wear. The stakes are really high in this. So the winning team, so you're going to pick a color based on your team, wins. Does anybody remember in the original Iron Chef what you would win if you beat the Iron Chef? No? So in the original Iron Chef, the one that's dubbed and everything, that's great, really campy, if you beat the Iron Chef, you received accolades throughout the land. So the stakes we're playing for could not be higher. Okay, so the first thing I want you to do when this comes up is I'm going to ask you to pick a team. So if you want to be on red, type A. If you want to be on blue, type B, orange, C, D, etc. Now, I just want you to know, yeah, blue won last time, so don't let that influence you. All right, not many red fans here, I see. Oh, there we go. A little bit orange. A little more blue, yep. Blue always seems to be the most popular. I'm not sure it's the best disguise, but green seems to be taking hold here. Orange is coming up. Now, the nice thing about this is it's anonymous, so no matter which team wins, you can claim victory. Okay. Yeah, okay. All right. Everybody good? Okay, so let's go on. So the news of the disengagement was spreading. Disengaged learners are everywhere. Learning suffers. Is boring online learning the cause? Gamification learning, one of five. There's always one newspaper that, you know, is not quite with it. Okay, students are not engaged. Why? So let's find Ivan the informant. He's going to give us some information. I knew one of his old haunts. He was about as friendly as a fly at a fly strip convention. Hello, Clueless. Look, I'm going to give you some clues about engaging learning, and you need to give me the right answer. So what do you and your detectives, that's you, have to say about this? Are games and gamification the same thing? So if you think they're the same thing, you think that's a fact, go ahead and type fact. If you think, nah, you know, they're not really the same thing, type fishy. Now, I don't use true and false, I use fact or fishy because my oldest son, when he was 17, 18 years old, he was gifted with this amazing skill set. Maybe your kids have it, maybe not. But my son at that point knew everything. So whatever I told him was false. So I'd say, Nate, it's a beautiful day outside. He'd say, false. There's a cloud in the upper left-hand quadrant of the sky. Therefore, it's not as nice as it could be. So I'm like, you know what? We're not doing that anymore. So we do fact or fishy. So he wouldn't say fishy. All right, so let's see what the general consensus is. Okay, so there's a couple people on the red team that think it's a fact. Orange is all in that it's fishy. And then green is kind of the same way, 20%, red 20%. So the actual answer is they're not the same thing. So gamification uses parts of games added to other elements, in our case, instruction. It does not use an entire game. It's not an entire gameplay experience. The other thing to think about with gamification is it's not about fun. People always say, oh, gamification is about fun. We want to make learning fun. But actually, gamification is about engagement. You know, if you want your learners to have a lot of fun, give them tickets to an amusement park, right? But what we want is them to be engaged. So what we want to do is borrow the engaging elements from games and integrate those into our instruction, not simply make it fun. Game-based learning, which is also a legitimate way to learn, is typically a self-contained experience that has a very clear beginning, middle, and end from a learning perspective and uses lots of different game elements. Now, people always often ask me, Karl, well, how do we get, you know, how do I know how many game elements I add to instruction before it becomes, it moves from gamification to a game? So I always say the answer is three. The same number of licks as it takes to get to the center of a Tootsie Pop, right? Nobody really knows what the answer is, and you can kind of see that. And also, I often argue it doesn't really matter. What matters is the learner engaged in the instruction? Are they engaged through gamification elements? Are they engaged because it's a game? You've got to figure out what makes them engaged. So we need to use elements of engagement. So how many types of gamification do you think there are? Do you think there's one type, two types, three types? So go ahead and type in A if you think, you know, there's just one type of gamification, B if you think there's two types, or C, obviously, if you think there's three types of gamification. So let's see what everybody says. Okay, a little bit more mixed. Orange is in at 77%, says there's three. Red says there's three different types, one, two, and three. Orange is totally not into one type. Okay, so let's see what the answer is. There's actually two types of gamification. Not likely at all. Let's talk about the two types of gamification. He grabbed his typewriter and made some notes to explain the difference between the two types of gamification. So one type I categorize structural gamification. And this is the one you're probably more familiar with. It uses points, badges, and leaderboards typically to frame instruction. So it adds game elements around the instruction, but doesn't impact the instruction at all. You're not changing the instruction, you're adding game elements around the instruction. And this is where the complaint about gamification comes in, where it's all extrinsically motivating, right? They say, well, gamification is bad because we're just extrinsically motivating people. In fact, I was doing some work in Mexico for a company called Grupo Salinas, and it's the second biggest conglomerate in Mexico. And the chairman, I was meeting with the chairman, he flies in, apparently, in this helicopter. We go into this beautiful oak conference room. He walks in, immaculately dressed. Very first thing he says to me is, I hate the word gamification, in perfect English. I'm like, ooh, this is off to a good start. And I'm like, I didn't invent the word. I didn't invent it. But lots of people have virile reaction to gamification. They don't like the word because they feel it's very manipulative and it's all external motivation. And it's not. It's not. It has elements of external motivation, but when we talk about intrinsic and extrinsic motivation, a lot of us believe that they're two opposites of a spectrum. So you're either intrinsically motivated or extrinsically motivated. Well, it turns out, problems with that. In some of the original research, the instruments were created so people could not simultaneously be intrinsically or extrinsically motivated. You couldn't pick one. You couldn't pick both. You had to pick one or the other. The other thing is, most times in real life, we are both intrinsically and extrinsically motivated. So let's say we're going to get a master's degree. We might want the master's degree because we really like that knowledge and it's really interesting. But oh, by the way, I might get a raise. So the raise is your external motivation, right? So typically both work at the same time. So to say that we can manipulate people just by points is not 100% genuine. And there are actually some value in points. For example, points can tell you how well you've done. If you could get up to 10 points, but you only got 5 points, you know, I still have a way to go. So points can actually be informative. Now, we have to be careful. Leaderboards can be helpful. The neat thing about leaderboards is they're self-setting goals, right? As soon as you see a leaderboard, you know what you're supposed to do. Nobody has to explain to you. You know you need to be at the top of the leaderboard or you want to try to get there. The problem, though, with most leaderboards is the first 10 people are psyched. The 11th person, not so much. The 100th person doesn't care, right? I mean, I like to run, but put me on a leaderboard with Usain Bolt, and not motivated at all, right? He's done with the race, he's at home, and I'm, you know, rounding the first bend, right? So that's not gonna work. So one of the things about leaderboards is to use group-based leaderboards. A group-based leaderboard means that people will want to contribute to the overall outcome, to their overall group, so they're more likely to be contributing in a group-based leaderboard. The other thing to think about with gamification is you can't make it all about winning. In fact, you want to make the stakes as low as possible. Otherwise, people focus only on the winning. So earlier, remember what this group will get if you win? Accolades throughout the land, right? So, I mean, it seems like a big deal, but it's not really, right? So the stakes are a little bit low. So that focuses on the learning, not on the winning of the element. And badges, people say, well, you know, badges are just manipulative. But badges have internal and external motivation as well. Think of the Boy Scouts, right? They've had badges literally for years. Think of karate. You've got belts. So the belt is a sign of recognition, and you work hard for that. And I can tell you, I know lots of people that have a black belt, and they're not getting a black belt just to have a black belt, right? I mean, there's a lot of mastery. There's a lot of autonomy. There's a lot of things that go into that. So structural gamification is, some people say it's all bells and whistles. It's not. It actually is a combination of intrinsic and extrinsic. And very interestingly, there's even some research that indicates extrinsically motivating rewards can eventually become internalized. So for example, if your parents are on you to get an A all the time in the early grades, at some point in time, that can become an intrinsic motivational element. So more research needs to be done on that, but there's definitely some of those elements. So let me give you another definition. This is content gamification. So content gamification is actually altering the content itself to be more game-like. So a good example of this would be, instead of starting learning with objectives, start learning with the challenge. I think one of the things, I often speak to corporate audiences, one of the things in corporate learning that's happened is they've dummied down the instruction so far that it's meaningless. And if something is meaningless, then nobody cares, right? So when they do policy instruction or they do safety instruction or whatever, they water it down so much so that everybody can do well and everybody shows quote-unquote mastery and all that kind of stuff, but they don't challenge the learner. We like to overcome challenge. That's a motivational element that we use. So we need a little bit of challenging. Now, we can't challenge somebody in something that they can't do. You can't say, okay, Karl, I want you to do brain surgery, right? So I need a little bit of scaffolding to get there. Okay, I need a lot of scaffolding to get there, but that's something that we need to think about. So content gamification uses challenge, story, characters, and missions. So Ivan grabbed his laptop to show me a demonstration of the two types. So this is structural gamification. This is a package called Mind Tickle. There's lots now of vendors who have structural gamification. Mind Tickle, Exonify, M-Level, Q-Stream, tons of them out there. So what happens is you come into this particular learning event, and it looks like Pinterest. And you can see that for each course, there are points. So you can earn points as you go through this course. You can see that you've got badges that you can earn if you go ahead and do really well in the course. And you've got a leaderboard, so I can see how I'm doing in the leaderboard. And the research is really interesting in terms of competition. The research shows the smaller number of people you're competing against, the more likely you are to compete. So if there are thousands of people, you typically say, wow, there's thousands of people. There's no way I'm going to do that well. So you're not as competitive. If there's only 10 people, you're like, hey, I bet I can beat, you know, these people beside me. So keeping the number of people you're competing against in gamification is good. The other thing that I want to mention is we often forget in gamification about cooperative learning. Gamification and games don't have to be competitive. So there's a really fascinating game called Forbidden Island. Somebody play that game? So it's a great game. So what happens basically is the island's sinking, and each person playing the game gets a different role, and all the roles are complementary to one another. So one person can swim underwater, pretty valuable when the island's sinking. One person can pilot the helicopter, pretty valuable for getting off the... But one person can't get off the island by themselves. All four of you have to work together. So when we think of gamification, we don't often think about cooperative, but cooperative is a really good option for gamification. So what happens here is you would, in this particular case, watch the video. You could vote the video up or down. You would get points for watching the video. So this is all a structure around that particular process. You also then get lifelines. So the more questions you answer, the more lifelines you get, the more you can go into the element there. And then when you're done, you get badges and you get lifelines, and it continues on. So that's structural gamification. Then content gamification, it's a little like deja vu, this content gamification, right? We're changing content to be more game-like, but this isn't actually a game. We're just using that as a structure. So it has elements of story, character. It has things that are more game-like. We didn't start with learning objectives, you know, those types of things. Okay. I've been talking for a while, now it's time for Twitter mission. So you've had your devices out, you're probably dying to tweet, so go ahead and tweet. So you can, NDFL games. Game? Yeah. So that's not entirely correct. If you're really bored with that, you could go, there's some lynda.com courses you could check out. Check that out. Okay, is everybody good with their Twitter mission? So the point of doing Twitter mission is if we ask people to engage in learning and we want to make sure that we have their attention, it's a little unrealistic. Like, how many people here have ever been to a webinar Nobody? Okay. And not check their email. Anybody been to a webinar and not check their email? Okay, we've got a couple people. The majority of people are checking our email all over, right? So rather than pretending that doesn't happen, why don't we build that into the process? Okay, we're going to go in the webinar, 15 minutes. If you guys need to check your email, do it, and then I want your attention back. So we can go ahead and do that. The other thing that we don't think about in designing learning is, this happens a lot in TV, is this thing called a curve of interest, right? So I always watch, to show you how much fun I am, my wife and I are, we watch CSI. And at the beginning of every show, we always turn to each other and say, hey, I wonder if anybody's going to die. So yeah, I told you we're a blast. But how CSI works is it starts with this really climactic moment, and then, you know, it goes through some exposition about what's happening, and then you think, it was the butler. And then all evidence points to the butler, and it builds up, and it finds out it's not the butler, and then kind of goes down again, etc. We often don't do that in the development of our learning, right? We kind of present some content, and then we hope that people get it. If we're smart, we use Gagne's 9 events of instruction, but oftentimes I see those used at the beginning, but not throughout the instruction. We got to think that we're not going to have the attention 100% of the time. We need to build things in to try to get the attention. Okay, welcome back, detectives. Let me talk to you about a robust educational phenomenon. So one of the reasons why gamification works is not necessarily because it's motivational. A lot of people think, it's the motivation. And actually, in terms of games, there was a really interesting meta-analysis that showed learning is a result of games, but not necessarily motivation. People aren't necessarily more motivated to play games. In fact, there are many people that don't like games. And the thing I find about those folks is they're really proud of it. They'll tell you as soon as you break out that game, right? Now, there's plenty of people that don't like lectures, but they don't say anything. There's plenty of people that don't like discussion. They don't say anything, like literally, right? But game people, they're really proud of the fact that that's fine if that's how you want to live your life. But the idea is if you know it's a sound instructional methodology, you got to keep with it, right? I don't like to get shots, but I take shots from the doctor, right? Because I know they're good for me. So if it's a good learning experience, it's good. In fact, research shows that people don't have to indicate they're enjoying a game to actually learn from the game. Now, that doesn't mean make the game horrible, so it's a bad experience. But the idea is actually the interactivity. That's what makes it effective for learning, not the points, badges, leaderboards, characters, etc. It's the interactivity. So when you think about designing instruction, how can we design it to be interactive? So one of the things is this thing called spaced retrieval, sometimes called distributed practice or drip learning or whatever. Basically what this is that you get a little bit of information over time. And it's much better than what's called cramming, right? How many people here have ever crammed for an exam and passed the exam? I would imagine everybody in this room, or you wouldn't be in this room, right? How many of you remember it like the next, 2 days later, 3 days later, 4 days, right? It disappears over time because it's not an effective way to learn. But what is an effective way to learn is this drip learning, a little bit of learning over time. It really helps reinforce. In some cases, some research shows up to 8 years later, people were able to recall information. So here's an interesting study. This was done with a randomized trial, 500 subjects in India. They were all predisposed to type 2 diabetes. They had glucose intolerance. They broke them into two groups. One group got traditional diabetes training classroom. Make sure you work out, don't eat sugar, don't eat too much starch, what's your insulin, all that good stuff. The other group, however, got 2 text messages a day. One in the morning, one in the afternoon. So one was like, use the stairs instead of an elevator, avoid snacks while watching TV because you might overeat, that kind of stuff. For 2 years, they just sent them text messages. No points, badges, or anything. At the end of the 2 years, they reduced the incidences of type 2 diabetes by 36%, which is a pretty dramatic change when you think diabetes is very largely a behaviorally based, can be treated very largely by behaviorally based activities. So that little bit of reminder over time works. So the other element that works is this thing called retrieval practice. So we have spaced retrieval a little bit over time, and then retrieval practice. Retrieval practice basically is using exams or tests to strengthen knowledge. So it turns out that requiring somebody to retrieve knowledge in a question-type environment is much better for learning than either rereading or re-listening to the content. So when you give pop quizzes, or the professors give pop quizzes, or you had pop quizzes, those are actually really good for recalling learning because it creates more neural pathways to the information. And I just read recently some really interesting research. It was about math learning that showed that your brain builds neural pathways more actively when you get a question wrong in a math problem than when you get it right. So we're actually, if we get questions wrong, we're actually building our learning up more effectively than if we get questions right. And so this was a fascinating study about getting questions wrong. And here's the really fascinating thing, was that those pathways were built even if you didn't know you were wrong. And they speculate it's the mental activity of trying to figure out the answer. Yeah, I think this is it, I think, et cetera, as opposed to the ease of just answering it if you know you're right. So really interesting. So if you go through life knowing you're right, you don't build any neural pathways. So combining spaced retrieval and retrieval practice is really powerful. So giving people questions over time really works well. In fact, one study, it was physiology, the retention benefits were between 35 and 61%, on average 41% retention of knowledge. Now, the problem with this, however, can be illustrated like this. So my son was studying for the SAT. I said, Nick, I can help you do really well on the SAT. I know a couple things about learning and how learning works and everything like that. Of course, he knows everything. I know nothing, right? I said, Nick, why don't you spend like 15 minutes a day just studying like SAT vocab words? You'll be set. My wife's like, what do you mean? You can't study for the SAT. It's an IQ test. Da-da-da. You can't study for that. I'm like, ah, you can study for it. So he didn't want to do that, right? 15 minutes a day. So like a week later, he says, Dad, check this out. I'm like, what is it? And he goes, this is a cool little game app. Every day for like 10 minutes, I get this question that has to do with the SAT. And if I score points, I can do this. And if I get on the leaderboard, I can do this. And look, I'm beating my friend. I'm like, Nick, didn't I tell you this like a week ago? No, you never said anything. But the idea is it's that little bit of motivation that keeps you going. So yes, we all know we should do it for a few minutes every day, but we got a lot of things going on. It's not really that exciting, et cetera. But that little bit can actually help us learn and stick with it. So we need to think about, can we use gamification to help us engage in the content a little bit more? It can't be the sole motivation. So for example, we can't do things like star charts. Anybody here ever use star chart with their kids? Anybody? So star chart, for those of you who don't know, is you say to your child, hey, go brush your teeth and I'll give you a star. So the first time I did this to my son, I said, go brush your teeth, I'll give you a star. I never saw the kid move so fast. That kid was up the stairs, brushing his teeth, everything. So I turn to my wife, I go, oh my gosh, this parenthood thing is a piece of cake. I don't know why people have problems with this. When he's 16, we'll just say, you know, you want to drive a car, you have to earn so many stars. So I had it made. So that lasted like a day, right? So the next day, Nate, go brush your teeth, you'll get a star. No. Well, what do you mean? Like yesterday you really want a star? I don't want a star. Well, what do you want? I want two stars, right? Because if it's external motivation, the only way to continue the motivation is to up the reward structure. So now we give him a candy bar so he brushes his teeth, right? I mean, it doesn't work. So there has to be an internal motivation that's there. So we have to say to them, for example, hey, you want to do well in the SAT because you want to go to college, all that kind of stuff, and I know it's kind of a pain to study it, but here's an app that can help you do that. So we can position the gamification so that it emphasizes the internal motivation as well as the external motivation. So Ivan had a question for me, but I was the one who was supposed to be asking questions. Learners remember facts better when they're presented in a bulleted list or when they're presented as a story. So if you think, you know, they remember facts better in a bulleted list, that's a fact, or no, that seems kind of fishy. So do learners remember facts better when they're presented in a story or as a bulleted list? Learners remember facts better when presented as a bulleted list rather than a story. So if you think it's a bulleted list, it's fact. If you think a story, it's fishy. Okay, red's all in on fishy. Oh, there's always somebody going, yeah, I don't know about that answer. All right, the truth of the matter is that's fishy. Bulleted lists are not as effective for learning as stories. And think about elaboration theory, right? A story elaborates and makes more neural pathways to the information we're trying to get out, and so stories work really well. Let me give you an example. This was Nike Plus. This was heralded as like one of the best gamified running apps ever. And it had every gamification element you could think of, right? It's got levels. You can see yellow, orange, green. It's got points in the guise of miles, how many miles I ran. It has goals on the bottom. It has everything. But after a while, just like that example of my son, it loses its motivational power. But it doesn't mean I don't run. I still run, but now I run from zombies. So this is an example of how story adds the context. So in this game, it's post-apocalyptic Earth, which is inhabited by zombies, right? It's not an when it's going to happen. It's not if it's going to happen. It's a when is it's this going to happen, right? And it's not the zombies that I grew up with. Like, when I grew up, zombies were the bottom of the monster food chain. They were slow. They were lumbering. You could outrun zombies. You could hit them with a shovel and they'd be dead. Not anymore. Zombies are fast, they're smart, and they're really hard to kill. Like, who came up with that? I don't know. But what happens is it does everything that Nike Plus does, but it has this story. You're runner number 5 in post-apocalyptic Earth. And so you're running and running and running, and it goes, boop, you picked up medicine, boop, you picked up supplies, boop, you picked up ammunition. And then all of a sudden, it goes, oh, runner number 5, remember how we said there were no zombies in Sector 12? There's a zombie. Now, at that point, I don't recommend screaming at the top of your lungs, zombies, everybody get out of here, because they will look at you very strangely. But now you're doing interval training, right? So it's this story, it's this continuation of the story that really helps. And games have levels that make us do that. And a really good example of this, but we don't do this in learning, right? We end a course or we end a class session and we're done, right? But what we need to do stuff like, does anybody remember that science show that was on a little bit? It had Walt in it, Breaking Bad. So in that show, at the end of Breaking Bad, well, the guy was a chemist. So it's kind of like a science show, right? And math, he cooks something. But at the end of that show, so one time it was on as a marathon. So at Christmas time, my wife and I sat down to watch the Breaking Bad marathon. And New Year's Eve, when we got off the couch, we said we got to make Christmas cookies, right? Because at the end of every episode, you couldn't believe what happened. You're like, oh my God, I can't believe Walt's the guy who knocks, right? And you can't believe this, you can't believe that, and you're like glued to it. We don't do that in instruction at all. We end the course, we end the class, and say, good luck, God bless, we'll see you next week, right? So what if we said, hey, now that we've learned all about this, guess what's happening next? These open, like, you know, if you see it on the internet, you'll call it clickbait, right? But these open-ended loops we need to think about. One of the things that we do in instruction that I don't think is very effective is we start, how do you start most modules? Learning modules, learning classes. Welcome, right? And then we have, yeah. Right, we give you the learning objectives. The problem with learning objectives is they're closed loops. You know, at the end of this class, you will understand the 3 causes of the Civil War. Yeah, I know 4. You're boring me. Right? But what if you said, do you know one of the unknown causes of the Civil War? I'll tell you. In class. So now it's an open loop. I might know, but I might not know. So starting class with objectives is a closed loop. We want to start class with an open loop to get curiosity, to have people be involved or be challenged with what the concept is. Use questioning techniques to do that. And then don't just do it at the beginning of class, right? We give you all the learning objectives at the beginning of class, and then at the end we kind of mention them. You learned all this stuff, now you got it. Why not sprinkle it through? Now that you know the number one hidden cause, guess who was responsible for it? I don't know. Well, let's figure this out, right? So you kind of go through that. So for example, I had one person say to me, you know, I teach like really boring material. I said, what do you teach? I said, you know, I teach anthropology, which is kind of boring. I said, what do you mean? There are 4 Indiana Jones movies about anthropology, and none of those were boring. Well, maybe the one with the silver skull. That was kind of dumb. But the point is, we can do this with lots of subjects. If we have the right context and we ask the right questions, we can involve the learners. And so that's something that can be really effective. If we use stories, research shows that stories are much better for, we have a natural affinity for stories. In fact, one really interesting research study shows that when you read a story, the area, and so let's say you're reading a story and somebody's problem solving in the story, that problem solving area in your brain lights up in an MRI. If you read about somebody running, that part of your brain that lights up when you run lights up in the MRI. So stories are basically a mental rehearsal for activity. So if we want to prepare students to work in the field, and be in the field that we want them to be in, stories are a really good methodology. Now, you can't just tell like old war stories. You know, hey, back when I was young, they have to have a point, and they have to have something that you want them to do, and they have to have a resolution and a learning arc and all that kind of stuff. But if done right, is a really effective methodology from a learning perspective. So I wanted to show you a use of a story and kind of putting this all together in a game-based environment. And this is a game that was created called Zombie Sales Apocalypse. And what this game is, it's designed to teach sales skills. What really was fascinating is Harvard Business Review did a article about most MBA programs teach marketing, but they don't teach any sales. So people graduate, and your first job, if you're in marketing, is typically some kind of sales job, right? Like my son, for example, graduated finance. His job, literally, he works in a professional network. So hedge fund people call up his firm and say, hey, we need somebody to talk to us about the oil industry. Can you recommend somebody? My son literally gets on LinkedIn, finds somebody who knows something about the oil industry, asks them if they want to consult, and makes the connection. That's his job on LinkedIn like all day. So talk about like technology and talk about like not understanding it or not doing it, but that's a sales job basically. So how this game works is you have to go in and you have to indicate what activities you would do prior to the sales call. So it breaks the sales model into different sections. We're not going to fill that out. We're going to take a shortcut. But you have to fill it out somehow. You can cheat like I'm cheating or... And then you figure out what materials you want to take with you to present. And then once you do that, you have to come up with your nickname. You select your avatar. You select your level of difficulty. That's for replayability because when you replay, you get to test out different strategies. And then, so you're in this office and you have to sell something to the broker. But the broker is infected with the zombie virus, so the broker's not really that friendly. So, and they may not be friendly in real life either, but so you walk over to the broker and you talk to him and it gives you the scenario and you figure out the scenario and then you answer questions based on the scenario. And then partway through the conversation, the broker just runs away. So you're like, oh great, now I got to go find the broker. And you have to go through this. And now you can see the zombies. And the zombies, if you bump into them, will steal your health on the right-hand side there. So then you come in, and I'm going to show this quick conversation. So then you talk to Dirk again, and then all the while the zombies are coming toward me, and if I look at my map, I can see the red there are zombies. So I can see the zombies are getting close. I'm actually kind of getting nervous. And you can answer the questions. We want it to be quick, but so that was a issue. There's a zombie, and then you can blast through walls. So if I don't want the zombie to come toward me, it blows up the wall. As you know, zombies can't lift up their legs, so they can't get over the wall. And then that's one thing we still have going for us. And so a couple more questions. Whoops. Oh, I'm not used to this computer. It's brand new to me. And so the idea is that you're rehearsing. Now, we wanted to keep the questions short because we didn't want to have a lot of reading. We wanted it to be a quick kind of in and out with the game. And we'll just do a couple more here because I want to get to the analytics. So the analytics provide rich insight into how well you did with the particular sales model. So now that we are there, we answer the questions, we go through. So this gives you the ability to apply what you're learning. Now, the way that a game best is for learning is most people say, hey, we want to create a game because it's stealth learning. The learners will never know that they're learning. That's the exact wrong way you want to present a game to learners. The research is pretty clear what you want to do. So what you want to do is you want to tell the learners what they're going to be learning. So that's why in the beginning of this game, we have the learners self-write what they're going to, what the objectives are for the sales call. Then you want to have the learner play the game. And then when they're done playing the game, you want to debrief them. So that's the best way to do learning. Set up the learning experience, let the learners have it, and then debrief them. So now I go to this interview. Here's the debriefing. Now, the only reason why we use my picture is because it's royalty free, which is my mistake. But otherwise, that's how we kept that royalty free. This is done in Unity, in case anybody wants to know what software it's done in. Submit the interview. And then this is what I wanted to show you. This is the analytics. So based on how you answered the questions, what you did, it tells you how well you were able to apply the sales model, the analytic model. So imagine this doesn't just have to be for sales. This could be for lots of different environments where you have a model and you have to apply the model. Maybe it's a project management model. Maybe it's a model for dealing with conflict. Maybe it's a model for communication. So all of these elements can be used from a learning perspective, and it's kind of like a game, and it kind of has some game elements. So I would say this is content gamification to kind of help through that particular process. So that's Zombie Sales Apocalypse. Okay, the mystery of interactive learning was starting to take shape. Thanks, Ivan. Get out of here. Remember, he's friendly as a fly. Anyway. Let's debrief the dean of what we learned so far. Okay, so far, what have you learned about games and gamification? Okay, and this would be like the interactive portion where I would ask a question and you guys would like respond. Yes. Two types of gamification. What else? Anyone? That's it? Yeah. Okay, good. Yes? Small bits of information over time. Stories to enhance retention. Extrinsic. Motivation. What's that? Oh, they can happen at the same time? Yep. Good. That's really good. Yes. Start with challenges. Okay, good. Yes. Right. Care more about engagement than motivation. Here's where somebody used to raise their hand and said, Karl can't type very well. Did you have something in the back table there? Doesn't have to be fun. Okay. Any, yes. Students should know they're learning, yes. Yeah, usually they're pretty smart, and they're like, okay, we're playing a game, we're in class, it's probably a learning game, right? So it's a really good idea, yeah. Yes. Don't have to be competitive, yes. Yeah, there's a really great cooperative game called Pandemic. It's a board game. If you have a chance to play that game, play it. Yes. Students should be debriefed afterwards. Okay. Anything else? Yes. Okay. So this group did an awesome job. So those are some things that we've learned about that. So far, so good. Follow the next clue in the matchbox I found in my desk drawer. Lights, camera, nightclub. I arrived at the place on the matchbook as shady as a clump of oaks caught in an eclipse. Who writes this? Okay, what could this location mean? Does engaging instruction start with content or does it start with action? So should we have engaging content start with, instruction start with content or action? And if I didn't stumble and give that away, there may be some intrigue here. Okay, so most people are saying action, and that's correct. We want action. So one of the things I often say, the difference between a game designer and an instructional designer is an instructional designer tends to think of content first and action later. A game designer tends to think of action first. So we need, as instructional designers, to start, then people design instruction, to think about what kind of activity can we have the learner do? Because action draws the learner in and gets them interested right away. And this doesn't have to be electronic. So for example, we're doing instruction one time for this company. They work for the DOD, and they had to do a lot of internal investigations, which didn't make me feel that good, but anyway. And they had this course developed with a subject matter expert who was a lawyer, and it was a beautifully traditional instructional design course. You had the learning objectives. I call them objections because they should not be used, but they should be used to design, but not to present to students. So anyway, they had the learning objectives. They had the terminology. They had the model. They had the forms that you used. And at the end, there was a little role play. So at the end of the 2 days of instruction, they knew about how to do an investigation, but they had never done one. They didn't know anything about it. So we turned it around. So as soon as the learners walked into the room, as soon as they walked in, they got a piece of paper that said, you're conducting an investigation. Somebody has just come up to you and accused your boss of embezzling $10,000. What do you do? That was it. There was no welcome to class. There was no, here's the learning, et cetera. And they had, so at first they're like, what do you mean? What do I do? Like, what? I'm in class. What? How come you're not telling me anything? And the instructor said, you got to figure it out. Figure out what would you do if this was real? Well, the first thing I do is check our manual to see what the protocol was. Okay, here's the manual, right? And they walked through, at the end, like they couldn't get them away from that class because they were trying to figure out what to do. I mean, they were so wrapped up. And they said, well, we need to talk to the boss. They had somebody ready to that. They came in and they interviewed the boss. Hey, we need to talk to this person. They had somebody, they came in, they interviewed that person. They conducted an entire investigation. And oh, by the way, they learned the terminology, they followed the model, and they did a role play. And they used the forms. They used the right forms. So it doesn't have to be an online experience to provide this kind of action to bring people into an activity. So we already talked about that. So what do we make the learners do? Well, why don't we have the learners identify something, a procedure right away? Which of the ways would you start? What would you do initially? Or solve a mystery. Here's a problem. Let's see if we can solve that or fix a problem. We could have them answer a question. We could have them do something simple like pick a team. We could have them confront a challenge or make a decision. Any of those kind of things work from a learning perspective. And if we think about it, again, it's not the game elements, it's engagement. There was a really interesting meta-analysis in the STEM fields, 225 studies that found people that had traditional lecture-based learning were 1.5 times more likely to fail. If we have action learning, there's 6% better test scores. So these can be really effective methodologies. So we want to do kind of like Law and Order, right? Anybody ever watch the show Law and Order? You know, it's 11 o'clock at night. You have a 7 o'clock meeting, and you're flicking through the channels. You come across Law and Order, and now you can't go to sleep till you find out, does that guy go to jail? And it's probably a repeat. You just can't remember if they go to jail, right? That's that open loop I talked about. Television does this really well. They present a problem. Another really good example of this, has anybody ever watched that show, House Hunters? Right. Now, I'm convinced, I have no evidence of this, but I'm convinced it's created by the real estate industry, right? It's not like this fun show. It's, we're trying to sell houses, how do we do that? The one brilliant thing they did is, they, like if you said to Karl, here's three pieces of real estate, you know, what do you think? I'm like, I'm not in the mood to buy, I'm not buying a house, whatever. But they don't. They have this couple, and the couple's trying to figure out which house to buy. And by the end of the show, you're screaming, what are you doing? Don't buy that house. That location sucks, right? You're totally into that TV show, and there's no reason you should be in at all, right? It's Chicago. It's this couple buying a house. You don't care about it. You're not in Chicago, nothing. But you're yelling at them for making the wrong choice. The way that show is set up is it gives you one, vested interest in what happens in the outcome. Two, it's a little bit of, are they right? Am I, you know, et cetera. And then they give you these pros and cons that you have to weigh, and you have to make a decision. So when you think about instruction, oftentimes we say, you know, here's what you need to do, or here's whatever. But imagine if you said, here's three different choices of attacking this particular problem, which one's the best? And let's walk through this process. And even if one of them is not the best, you can talk about, well, why did you think that? Why did you choose that? Why was that the one? So using, again, that kind of open challenge, identifying something early on and figuring out what you want to do is a really good way to draw learners into an instructional element. So think about using that element. And it's using games all the time. Games have these different levels, and you get to choose different levels. The other thing that games do really well that we don't do very well as designers of instruction is you can enter games at different levels. Most of the time in instruction, you can only enter in one level and everybody has to enter in the same level. And what games do really well is I have this game, you know, James Bond 007 Nightfire. You better believe I'm going in as a 007 agent, right? I get in there for 5 minutes, I'm not a 007 agent. Not working, right? So I back off and I go in the next level. But what did that do? We know adult learners learn best when they know they don't know something. So by going in at the most difficult level, I learned I don't know something. And now I'm more receptive to the learning because I know I don't know it. But think of the example before when I talked about, you know, the three causes of civil war. Yeah, I know the three causes, right? So now you kind of shut down. So you really need to think about, can we open up the adult learner and gently remind them that there's some things they don't know and some things they need to practice and work on. And by starting at a hard level, giving people choices to go into content is a really good way to do that, especially if it's self-paced content, right? Because you've got lots of different people in the class. It's harder to do in an actual physical, or as my one friend calls, meet space environment. But in a virtual environment, we can actually do that a little bit more easily. So we create these open loops to draw the learners in. So time for a recap with the dean. She looked a little frantic. She wanted to know one more thing. I want to know one more thing. What game elements can engage the learners. So in this presentation, I used a number of game elements. What are some of the elements? Again, this would be like the interactive session. Storyline? Open loops? Repetition? Problem solving? Choices? Zombies. It's hard to go wrong with zombies. I mean, it really is. Teams? Characters? What's that? Rewards? Yep. Else? Small bits? Somebody say? Entry level. Okay, so let's examine a couple of these. So great stuff. You folks really seem to have cracked the case of what makes engaging learning. So we talked about use of story, we talked about use of character, we talked about use of rewards, we talked about competition. We actually had some competition here going. I thought I was done, but then I found another pack of matches on my way home. Meaningful outcome cafe, start with the end in mind. But we'll have to leave that mystery for another presentation. All right, so let's take a look at some stuff. So did you write down some of the elements? So take a moment and talk to the person sitting next to you or at your table. What are some of the game elements that you saw, that you used, that maybe weren't mentioned up here? Give you just a couple minutes to do that. Okay, let's go ahead and regather. Let's go ahead and regather. So let's clap once if you can hear me. Twice. Three times. Okay, that works really well, MJ. Thank you. So I guess I just plagiarized her idea. So let's take a look at some of the things. So what are some of the elements that went into the design that you mentioned at your table that we haven't mentioned already? Any? Just give me two or three. Engaging graphics? Humor or attempted? Yes. Engaging instructor? Thank you. Energy. Knowledge of the topic. Any last burning one? I'm sorry, what? Direct instruction? Okay, so let's have some time here at the end. So here are some things that I came up with that have to be thought about. So one is the story or genre. So I kind of use a story. And notice I used the noir genre, detective noir genre. So you kind of have to make some changes, right? That was a very 1950s, a whole different sensibility. So you have to make some changes there. I used polling as well as other forms of audience input. I really believe in any kind of, and you can use this polling software online as well, so you could use it in a virtual classroom as well. But I believe we can't just rely on one methodology of engaging students. We need to do things like where we ask questions, and we want to do that as well. Notice also the questions were used for reflection. So I'm a strong believer that there's no learning without reflection, there's only experience. So So we want to try to get the learners to reflect on what they've experienced. We use the sense of teams. We use this mystery or curiosity or the appearance of mystery or curiosity, right? So if you think about it, it's just basically a set of multiple choice kind of questions that we answered, and then we talked about each of the answers. So it's a really good methodology to do that. I do another thing where it's a whole game, fact or fishy. So I have students come in and they answer questions of whether or not this is true or not, basically from the reading that they've done before. We use characters, we use some competition, group participation, action. You actually had to use your phone, you had to do some things. So that can be really helpful. Now, I appreciate someone saying that they like the graphics. One time I did this presentation and the feedback I got was cheesy story, bad graphics, and too much interactivity. And I said, well, okay, what's that? It's a game hater, right. I said, I'll give you, maybe the graphics could have been better. Maybe the story wasn't that good. I know that. But too much engagement? Like, I won't give you that one. But my point is, maybe they are, but how can you use this in what you're designing, right? So if you don't like the graphics, do better graphics. That's not a problem. If you don't like the story, do a more realistic story. But the point is, don't throw it all away because you didn't like, you know, one aspect of it or whatever. The point is, you can use these techniques to drive learning and to drive engagement. So for example, if you're doing something in medical, you said, look, you don't have to have a detective. You could ask questions. Okay, what are the symptoms or signs of Zika, right? So you could bring that into the situation. In every discipline that you're teaching, somebody has a job in that discipline, right? They're preparing for something. So you can bring in a scenario or a situation or a narrative that they need to apply this knowledge to get to their outcome or get to their goal. So this technique can be really kind of a good way to do that, a good way to think about that. You know, given these symptoms, what would you do? So now I'd like to open it up for questions that you might have related to gamification or games or any of the topics that we discussed. Yes. I got the graphics from a graduate student. I commissioned her to draw the graphics. Yeah. Kristen Bittner, she did a great job. Yes. Right. So I would definitely say that the first time you do this, it is very time consuming. So you know, it took her a while to draw the graphics and I had to come up with a story. But I used some things. So for example, I have only two images of the detective. So rather than building an entire set, if you will, I just use a gray background. So you could do, so the desk, the dean in this case, and the doctor are all separate pieces. So I can bring those in when I need to do them. The other thing I would argue in that sometimes you can very quickly copy information from an article and paste it into a PowerPoint slide and then read it to your students, but that might not be the most effective thing. Sometimes building in a story is a great way to do that, and I will tell you that once you've done this a couple times, it's much faster. So getting used to using story-based learning in this type of gamification takes a while to get at first, but then once you've got it, it actually is a lot faster. And once you have, like you probably have much disposal of a lot more graphic artists than I have, you could create a library of characters and just keep pulling characters into different situations and using them. It becomes really kind of helpful. The other thing that you can do, and I've done this in classes, I've had students, I said, okay, I want you to do this as an assignment, and they create it, and then the best of them, I say, can I use this in my next class, because this is a really good example, and then often they let you do that. So yeah, really good question. Yes? Okay.
I'm going to give you the mic here.
A lot of times I try to do the low-tech version, which involves paper and writing things down. And then if I have time, I migrate it into something more design heavy and high tech. So sometimes you can just have them draw on a piece of paper, and that can be just as effective as having a computer generated graphic.
Absolutely, yes. Yeah, good point.
If you are interested in a computer animated graphic, there's a website and a way to do it. It's called gotoanimate.com or goanimate.com. There's some free and some subscription based, and it's kind of easy to use. So if you are, and a disclaimer, I don't work for them or get any commission.
Yeah, and I'll add, this presentation is all PowerPoint. So it's not a special technology, except for the polling technology, which is Poll Everywhere. And if you're interested in Poll Everywhere, actually, you can get a free account from them if you want to email them. So, but the idea is, and it's not a, the only exchange is they let me use it for free, and I get to give it to people, so they're not paying me or anything. But you can experiment with it, practice with it, kind of go there. The thing you have to do is you have to segment every question based on the first question, which is what color, you know, what team are you on? And then every question, that's how it segments. So good question. And GoAnimate is a wonderful, wonderful tool. Okay, are there other questions? I'm trying to get to...
Yes, Karl.
I want to get to the...
I don't have a question, yeah. Really, just a comment. If everybody, maybe not everybody's old enough, but some of us are old enough to remember the... original game consoles in the 80s and how terrible the graphics were, and yet how popular they were. And I think it's because they effectively used stories and problem solving and things like that. So just a few pixels on the screen, but you're told this is Yar the Barbarian, and you're like, oh, that is Yar the Barbarian. How's he gonna get through this quest? So the graphics don't necessarily matter if you bolster them with all these other elements.
Yeah, that's a really good comment. Yeah, and in fact, I always say to people, if you've ever read a book and laughed and cried, that's just black print on a white background. So we can set the imagination with just a few things and have people really take to that. Yes?
How much are the issues present in gender differences with respect to gaming relevant to gamification?
I'm sorry.
How much are the issues associated with gender differences in gaming relevant to gamification?
Yeah, that's interesting. So gamification first came on the scene in about 2002, and so now we're at 2016, but it really didn't come online until like 2010. So there's not a whole lot of study right now about what are the major gamification differences among gender. So I typically fall back on, the game research to use that to inform me about gamification till we get some more information. So broad brushstroke, females tend to like gamification in games where there's more social interaction. They tend to take to games that are not like a lifetime commit. Like guys will play till level 99 of World of Warcraft, women not so much. The fastest growing actually segment of gamers are women over the age of 40 who play what are called casual games. So that's your Bejeweled, that's your Candy Crush, that's those types of games that work really well for that. Men tend to prefer first person shooters, but these are very broad brushes. You'll find exceptions everywhere, and you'll also find exceptions for age. So I think it's not so much a proclivity. I think it's what you're used to, right? So if you're used to certain kind of games and interactions, you're more comfortable with them, so you like them a little bit more. If you're not used to them, you're not quite as comfortable. So that's kind of where I do the age thing. But there is some, I joke about, texting and the students and how fast they text. There are some, things like that you just need to think about. But I haven't seen it be a showstopper. And what I try to do is work both of them into. So some gamification, I want one that has a social aspect where people can talk and compare stuff, but I also want that competitive aspect. There's another researcher who says there's four types of gamers. Bartle, his name's Bartle. So there's a socializer. There are people that like to get into a game and socialize and talk to each other and meet people and hang out. There are people that like to explore the game environment. They want to figure out how everything works. So if you come in, they can tell you, hey, you know, there's an Easter egg over here. There are people that are achievers. They want to do as well as they can in the game. And then he identified a fourth called killers. And they were people that want to do well at the expense of everybody else. So you probably know somebody like that. Or if you don't, then it's probably you and your social group. But those are the four broad categories that I try to keep in mind. Not so much the killer, but the other three as I think about how to position gamification. Yeah, good question. Thanks. Other questions? Yes. Making MJ run over there.
You're going to have to make me run.
Right. So one area that games and gamification do really poorly is ADA and 508 and that kind of stuff. So there's a couple ways to handle that. One is there's a lot of tools that you can make it more quiz-based and give points and that, but not have like the elaborate graphics that you had for Zombie Sales Apocalypse. So all those questions are in a HTML XML file. So we can put that XML file in a different format. So it's not exactly the same game, but it is the an experience that doesn't leave them out of the experience. So oftentimes we'll use a written scenario to kind of tell them what's happening and then give them scenario-based questions for the game experience. And that works to a certain extent. But what we do is let them know that they're not a forgotten citizen, that even though it might not be exactly an equivalent experience, it's as close as we can get with the technology. Did you have a comment? Or? Right. Yeah, that's a good point. And in fact, there's a lot of research that shows scenario-based learning is a really effective methodology for learning, case-based learning, that kind of stuff. So you can add some game elements into the case situation and allow that kind of to happen. Yes. Yes. Yep. Absolutely. Yeah.
We have one over here, Karl.
Right. So he had mentioned the power of the hero's journey, where you start with an ordinary person, they encounter a struggle, this is the abbreviated version, they think they've overcome the struggle, but they really haven't come the struggle, they have a moment of crisis, whether or not I'm going to go forward or not. Usually a wise person of some sort provides them with some information, then they overcome that, then they come home, that kind of hero journey is a really powerful tool for framing your stories. Yeah, absolutely. Thank you. Yes?
This is a follow-up back to the learning disabilities question.
Sure.
In the early 1990s, there was a researcher at St. John's College in Jamaica, New York, Dr. Robert Zenhauser, and he was principal investigator for a grant in which he brought learning disabled students into a text-based virtual reality. And I worked with some of those students as a volunteer. They were primarily in the K-8 system in Canada. And they came in and we found all of the elements that you've mentioned this morning were extremely effective with these students. The one area where we did have some problems was social interactions, because the MU environment, multi-use object oriented, is a very social environment. But what we found was that their communication skills rose, especially with autism, high functioning autism, and oddly enough, OCD. So we don't tend to think of those as learning disabilities, but they do impair students in a traditional classroom. So the research is very old. It's probably hard to find these days, but it was published under the keywords computer mediated communication.
Okay, yeah, very interesting. I was not aware of that research. Thank you.
coming. They're starting to mess with me now. They're going back and forth.
Right, yeah, they're not.
They're texting each other.
Right, I think they're doing it on purpose. Right.
I hope you had your Wheaties. In my experience, and probably traditionally, digital natives have no problem with gamification. But how do you deal with the digital immigrants?
Right. So a lot of there's two things that are going on. One, the sensibility has definitely changed, right? So when I'm kind of on the cusp of the end of generation, beginning of Generation X, almost end of boomers. So there's some game background and some game things, but not that much. So there's sensibility, you know, you work is here and play is here, and the two don't really need to mix. That's not a good thing. But my son mixes, you know, all that kind of stuff. So what we found is to be most effective is helping through the onboarding. So where people get very frustrated with games, like when Second Life was out, where a lot of people broke down totally in Second Life, was moving that stupid avatar from point A to point B was really difficult if you weren't used to being a gamer. So the onboarding, the first half an hour, is the most critical element of that. So oftentimes, we'll walk people through level one to give them a sense of experience. The zombie sales game, I skipped it, but there's an entire tutorial level that you can't start the game unless you go through that tutorial. So what we found is to get them on board so that they're not frustrated. Usually once they get in and get it, then they enjoy it and they have a good time and everything. Not always, but most of the time. But it's that first half an hour that we find is most critical. If you can get somebody on board and comfortable, and then the other thing is if you can let them play the gamification experience at a non-risk environment. So you can say, look, level one doesn't count to anything. Just go in level one, you can do this, it's not a big deal, etc. And then not only have we walked them through, but then we go let them play on their own to become comfortable with it. So it's kind of like the trialability, let me check it out. Observability, let me see somebody else doing it. Is it kind of like something I've done before? So if you look at those kind of the diffusion of innovation attributes, applying those. So easy onboarding, focused onboarding, time to play, low stakes, and then get started. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
There are, when it comes to, trying out something new, maybe online, there are two groups of people, maybe two rough groups, and they might correlate with digital natives and digital immigrants. But one is, let me get in there and I want to try it out. I don't care if I fail. I just want to get right into the environment. And then other people are like, whoa, this is scary. Is there an instruction manual I can read first? Was the tutorial more like one or the other? Or did it try to accommodate?
So the tutorial that we've developed was showing people exactly what they need to do. And then we've also toyed with the idea of, hey, I'm a gamer, let me through. You know, that kind of a button. We didn't do that right away because it's so interesting, especially with the Zombie Sales Apocalypse game. The people that don't play games at all hate it because, you know, this is tough. And the people that are like Assassin's Creed people, Halo people, hate it because it's not Assassin's Creed. Like, yeah, Assassin's Creed's so much better than this zombie game. This is stupid. I don't have $11 million to develop the game. So, haven't got that grant yet. So, the idea is most people in the middle will accept kind of the walking through or whatever, but it's those people at the end that you definitely have trouble with. And then, again, you know, I find sometimes up to 30% of people don't like a game because it's a game. And so you kind of have to overcome that as well.
I think we have time for one more question.
Okay.
Who's got the best one? It's not a competition, though. In the corner? I'm coming. Here, let me. Thank
you. Yes. The virtual reality will be combined to this gamification theory as well, I think. But as you know, already we kind of heard about the many problem causing by the virtual reality, emotional something, I forgot the word. Do you know any terms for that? Yes, emotion sick, something like. Yes, so I thought there must be probably also other side effect caused by the gamification game stuff do you have any kind of backup kind of advice for that?
Some games, so for example, if you play a PlayStation game, they'll some of the flashing of the game can provoke some people into epileptic seizures. So sometimes a disclaimer is good to let people know that that's a possibility and give them an opportunity to opt out. And I know that some of the motion sickness and everything, especially the VR, is still, the technology's still not quite there yet. It's so funny because I studied virtual reality in graduate school, you know, with the big helmets and the wires and everything like this. And it's shrunk, but we still haven't worked out like the seasickness. So I think that the thing I want to say about virtual reality and augmented reality, like Pokemon Go and all that kind of stuff, is it does have educational potential, but a lot of what we've been doing in the education field, especially the training and development field, is every new technology, we're like, okay, we got to do that from a training perspective, right? So when the iWatch came out, like there were articles on iWatch training. Like, okay, who needs iWatch? Like, seriously? Like, how am I going to, you know? So the thing is, I think we need to spend a lot of time on the pedagogy. So, for example, gamification, often, as I talk about the distributed practice, is questions, right? Most questions don't get past the basic level of Bloom's taxonomy, right? They're comprehension questions. Now, theoretically, you can get to synthesis in a multiple choice question. I've just never seen it in the wild, right? So most of the time we default to these comprehension type questions. So one of the things I think we need to do before we jump into a lot of technology is go back to some, you know, blocking and tackling, some basic pedagogical functions, and say, how do we get everyone to write really good thought-provoking questions before we have all of these, you know, questions? How do we make augmented reality meaningful? Like, you're not just chasing something because we think that would be cool. Same thing with virtual reality. So what makes sense to put somebody in a VR situation that you can't do any other way? So for example, in Second Life, there was a really good example of this island where it mimicked having schizophrenia. So you could go in there and you could experience it. That's great use of that kind of technology. But I went into other Second Life areas where, like, I went into, the first time I was in Second Life, we went into this class, English as a second language, right? So first of all, it's my first and unfortunately my only language. And then we went into this virtual classroom. We sat on virtual chairs and we watched virtual PowerPoint. I'm like, no, that's not the way to use this technology, right? Put me in a restaurant and force me to order dinner, right? Have me in a, drop me in the middle of a city and have me find the bus station. Like, don't lecture to me in this rich data, you know, this rich environment. So I think a lot of times we kind of mimic what the old was without really embracing what we need to do. Second Life to me was all about field trips, right? And we'll come back to that, but it'll be a while. So Pokemon Go is all about understanding the context, I think, of where you are. And does it make sense to put somebody in the context and overlay learning over that? If it doesn't, don't do that. So I think we really need to be smart, especially us. I mean, our job is to create meaningful instruction. We need to be really smart about how we're going to do that. And we need to be really judicious about making decisions about doing this or doing that or doing that. It's okay to have a couple, like, you know, skunk work projects, but I think we need to really think through the educational impact of those projects first. Yeah.
So I think we're at time. Am I to understand the green team
won? It looks like the green team won. That's
and
correct.
And now everybody so in the room is going to claim to have been on the green team, right? Because it was
team,
anonymous.
Yeah.
Join me in thanking Karl for this wonderful presentation.